Nelson.
Here.
Tom Coons. Emily Leach.
Here.
Andrea Anderson.
Here.
Erin Kavanaugh.
Here.
Thank you. We'll stand for the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic of which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So we have a couple newer faces. We have a face we haven't seen in a while at our table here. Lori Lane is joining us tonight, and she's a local announcer. I think most of you are reporting this event, that's a mission last month, and she's here again. All right, we'll get right into it. Comments by visitors. Next up is the consent calendar. On the consent calendar, we have our minutes from last month, and then we'll draw the minutes from September. Motion to accept, second. Any further discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Announcements. We will look to Lori, see if there is superintendent updates.
Just have a couple of little things. It's great to be back here. Sitting in for Dr. Godomsky. He's away for a few days, so he asked me to come in instead. He didn't have anything specific that he wanted to report. I will just mention a couple of things. Usually in the board level, we remind folks that, you know, our professional development days are. We have one tomorrow. I know Rich talked about that in his report, so we may talk about some of the specifics of what those things that we do tomorrow. So I wanted to mention that. And one of the other things that I just wanted to mention briefly was October is a huge month for state reporting, you know, and it generates everything from testing monsters for your state testing to how there's a lot of work that we've been doing to try to make sure that everything, you know, not only your students that are involved, but also your students that go to Marshwood, the schools in Marshwood, are captured accurately. So we've been working on that. And I just wanted to give a shout out to Allison, the administrative assistant here at the school. She's been, she's a trooper, she's an Excel queen, which we've been really appreciative. So we've been down a couple of times. She's come up for some training. Opened up the opportunity tomorrow to come and do some other training. We've been working with some of the folks that are, because there's a lot, how school generates is where everything is generated from. And so we're just learning more about that system and how it's set up and how we need to set everything up correctly. And so Allison's been able to make some nice connections, also working with admin assistants in our office at the SAU, but also in Summer's work. So they call each other and, you know, as we're trying to figure this all out. So I just wanted to recognize her that she's been, you know, really busy, because it's been challenging at times. So that's all that.
That's cool. I'm going to piggyback on that for a minute, because Bob and I have had some discussions about that as well. And the work that is being done by Allison and by other folks at the SAU office and other administrative assistants in other buildings in the SAU used to be outsourced from the SAU, and as a cost savings kind of thing, it was brought in house. And the administrative assistants in the various schools are the ones who are students best in some way. So it really did seem like a good decision. I think you're instrumental in some of that work, and make that happen, and doing a lot of work. And so it seems like a good distribution of putting things where the putting work where the knowledge is, and saving the SAU a little bit more.
It hasn't been without its challenges, and that we've all been learning together, and that's the team approach that's really been helpful. I mean, know what it's been a little crazy at times, so it's really trying to get through it, but we're getting there, and it's been great to have Allison be a part of that. So
that's good. Yeah, I also agree with you about that.
Yeah.
So thank you for mentioning that. Principal's update?
Yeah, I guess I'll start by piggybacking off it too. You know, when I first got here, Caroline was the secretary, and oftentimes if she didn't know something, there was one person that she went to. And now there's a wealth of people that Allison can go to because they've all been trained together and they're supporting each other. So glad I didn't have to answer this one. I wasn't going to talk about tomorrow, but I will now. It is our second professional development day with our literacy consultant that we've hired this year. Just to remind the board, we hired somebody through our Title IV grant to work with us on a self-study sort of our literacy instruction and our methods, making sure that there aren't any gaps in regular education. We've got a lot of kids that are struggling readers who receive extra support. So we're focusing mainly on our classroom instruction by the classroom teachers to make sure that kids get those foundational skills so that hopefully over time less kids need the extra support. We have a lot of kids coming out of the classroom to get that support. Obviously, the least restrictive environment is to keep them in the classroom. So we've just started digging in. It was more of an introduction the first day before school started. And then tomorrow we're going to continue our work. She's come to meet with each of the classroom teachers individually for half a day to get some feedback on them, on the direction that they would like to see her go. Study for us. It's always nice to self-analyze what you're doing and make your own decisions instead of somebody coming in and saying you need to do this and this and this. Because we do a lot of great things, but it's always nice to know that you're finding other things that you can improve on, especially when it comes to kids and their education. I want to talk about a few things in my report, key ones that I think should be publicly noted. We do have a new music teacher. He started on October 1st, Corey Wells. Most recently was a paraprofessional at Seacoast Charter School. But while he was there, he had a unique experience of teaching some music courses that were, I guess you could look at it as a high school elective course. Kids in the middle school were allowed to choose different music electives. Taught some of those in his capacity there. He's also a lifelong musician. He did some extracurricular at a couple of different places, his favorite being a rock band. So he's looking to bring some of those experiences with him here. He also has a PhD in history, and one of the things that really intrigued us during the interview process was his link of music and cultures. So he wants to dig into exposing kids to music from different cultures across the world. And so he's got a lot of great ideas coming in. This is his first music teaching position at an elementary level, but he's taught college courses, he's been at the middle school level, and now he's working with us at the elementary level. So we're excited to have him. We're slowly getting our chorus and bands back up into speed. I asked him to come in and just teach classes for the first couple of weeks, just to get his feet wet, get to know us, and get to know the kids. We've done our sign up for band, and we're going to start getting that going in the next week or so. Mr. Fortier is going to join us at our November meeting because we'll be doing an initial budget presentation for next year. He wants to make sure he's here to answer any questions, get any direction from the board on anything that you think should be next steps. He does, as always, have his sort of next projects in mind and thought about. And I'll let him talk more in November, but there's a couple of things 2 to 3 years down the road that he wants folks to start thinking about. He's been thinking about them for years, and I think it won't be a surprise to you, but you know, things that he wants you to start planning for as we get closer to the time. I did put in there a little bit on Emily Spear writing a grant to the NEA, but I didn't put the dollar amount. She wrote a grant. The name of the grant process, but it was through the NEA. It was for students and special students, instructional opportunities or exposing them to different things. The grant totals $2,000, which pays for their entire field trip to the Brown Center that they like to do each year. Typically, they do fundraising. In the past, they've done a GoFundMe page to get donations. I think last year, a lot of those donations came from Emily's and the patients and families. So to be able to write a grant and get all the money they need, you know, takes a load off the parents for having to, you know, bake brownies and cookies for bake sales and, you know, do a school store all the time to, you know, make $50 here, $100 there. So they're excited. They're going next week. The Brown Center is sort of a team building opportunity for kids, and it's an outdoor experience, which our kids always enjoy. A couple of community connection things. Goodwin Family Health was here last Friday. We had our second food clinic. Last year was the first time. We had 47 kids sign up. I don't think they all got it.
45
received. But it went very well. It was very efficient. They were in and out in less than 2 hours. For the most part, it went pretty well, I think. And today was Fire Safety Prevention Day. Our sponsor fire department was here doing their annual educational piece with the kids to come out to the fire trucks out in the parking lot, which was always a big hit. Second year in a row, we didn't do the fireman's muster, which I'm still waiting for. But he just didn't want to take a chance with, you know, the unsure weather, the wind, and everything. So, and plus with the little children, for kids to be out there quite a lot. And the other community thing is our PTO is doing a Halloween event this year, not too similar to the past. So it's not going to be sort of the haunted hallways like prior PTOs have done. It's going to be in the gymnasium. There's going to be games set up around the outskirts of the gym, music playing, and if kids want to dance, they can use the center of the gym to sort of dance and move around. It should be a pretty well-attended event. Our PTO events have been really well-attended since we sort of reinvigorated them last fall. The kids are already been talking about it. Looking forward to celebrating. And then the last thing I want to mention is Julie Person is putting on a series for the community, but mainly Rollins for grade school parents. But it is open to any community members, and she's titled it, It Takes a Village. It's a series of presentations that she's doing. I think she has 5 throughout the year. The second one is coming up in a couple of weeks, October 23rd, from 6 to 7:30. And each forum has a different theme, and this month's theme is personal body safety. You know, giving parents information on how to talk to their kids about personal body safety, signs to look for, you know, the differences between language and correct language around different body parts. So it's just some things that have popped up through the years that parents want more information on or need more assistance with. So she's using an educational approach. I think she had 6 parents in September. I can't remember the name off the top of my head actually. But, you know, first time she had 6 parents, and we're hoping for, you know, some more as the year goes on. So I'll try to make sure I put that on the calendar of events each time it pops up. All I was going to highlight, unless there's any other questions about my report.
Any questions for me? And we're still looking for a master coach.
Yes, we had an unfilled position in the budget, and we started the year without filling it because to start the year we didn't have the need. But as kids move in and move out, we have the need for it.
So we're still looking for something. us about the Marshall Heights School.
So as I mentioned last month, I did have my interview with the new principal, Mr. Scully, just to try to see his initial thoughts on the school and where he plans to break the school. And as I was saying, he did seem like a very genuine and caring person, really took the time to talk to me, kind of get to know me. One of his ideas that I found the most interesting was his idea on some of the controversial policies we have at school amongst the students, like the backpack policy and the cell phone policy, obviously, because we're being restricted in where and when we can have those, and a lot of students want to have them more. So I thought it was interesting what he told me. He kind of said he wants to look at what X, Y, and Z can lead to the right answer, and if the policies we have in place right now are that X, Y, and Z that we need, then that will stay in place. But obviously, he hasn't been around for, he's only been at the school for 2 or 3 months now, so he's still waiting to kind of see it, things as they go on. But he says that right now, it looks like the policies that we have in place are the right ones that fit the answer that we need. Last week, on Thursday and Friday, we had a few Danish exchange students. They shadowed kids throughout the school. They attended our pep rally on Friday. Always a school fun experience. I found it very interesting, their kind of viewpoints on society, I guess, as a whole. They were in my Gov class, in my AP writing class, and it was kind of interesting hearing about their culture and their views on the world and how different they are than our community as Americans. So, and obviously last week was our homecoming week. We had spirit week, so each day of the week was a different dress-up day, I guess. And then Friday we had a big pep rally with a freshman that went, which is kind of embarrassing. Yeah, it's hard to lose when seniors always win, but it happens. It's happened twice in 20 years, so it just happened to be lucky for us, I guess.
Sure, they are bragging this week.
Next Wednesday, the 9th, 10th, 11th graders take the PSAT. I don't have a lot of information about sports, but I do know that playoff season is approaching for football, soccer, I think it was a qualifying round the other day, so I have a few shoes. I'm participating in the next level of yesterday was the start of parent-teacher conferences, so there are 2 days where parents are coming to speak to the teachers. So the first day was yesterday from 3 to 8 o'clock, I believe, and the next day is next Thursday. And lastly, looking ahead, the only notable thing is that quarter one ends on November 1st.
Will the Danish students be around, or were they just there for that
Sunday? So they came into New York City, and they kind of just explored around the city, and then they came up to Maine for 3 days, I believe. So they came in Thursday, and they were gone that Saturday. Just kind of got the feeling of the school and kind of that.
Any other questions or comments? And Jackson, you're going to tell us a little bit about what's happening at the middle school, right?
Yes. So the first couple of weeks of school have been pretty good. Expectations so far definitely has meeted the standards. For school sports, everything's been going really good for all the teams. We have had some new teachers come in. We've had a new art teacher and a new French teacher, both really nice. So far, we have had some field trips so far. Seventh grade is having around 2 this year. They just went to Point Woods. We went to their Sarah Orne joining us for the first time. On the wall too. So far, we haven't really gotten to a lot of things yet. Really, it's just been going through just regular normal days. We just started off. Hawk Prize, we do that every Friday. So we recognize people who do the right thing or kind of help someone out one way or another. So, yeah.
You're a seventh grader, correct?
I'm an eighth grader.
You're an eighth grader?
Yeah, just.
So you've got a full year there, right?
Yeah.
So it's all of the activity.
Yeah.
Let's go. Thank you. Any questions for the council? All right, well, as usual, you are both invited to stay for the entire meeting if you would like to, but knowing that you are busy students and other things, you are also free. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next up is we have one discussion item, which is withdrawal committee update. Aaron and I both sit on the withdrawal committee. This is the Rollinsford withdrawal from SAU 56 committee. Very brief history. Back in September, Summersworth voted to and went through a process to start withdrawing from SAU 56. We received legal advice and also started our own withdrawal process. We started a number of joint meetings and Summersworth meetings alone and Rollinsford meetings alone. Each group came up with their own plan, and on Monday, is this Monday? Yes. On Monday, we had the final. The plan is now in the works. We saw the first draft of it, and the recommendation of the Rollinsford withdrawal committee is that Rollinsford the school department, the school district to withdraw, but that we then contract back with Summersworth for the SAU services that we need to have. So at that meeting Monday night, it was made clear then that now the withdrawal committee handed off to the school board. Now it is up to us to open negotiations with Summersworth to start contract negotiations for the services. One of the things that's going to make that very easy is that the Summersworth board has made it very clear that they're very happy staying with the current the formula we've been using for the last 50 years, however many years the formula has been in place, the same formula. So when we look at the SAU budget that we will see at our next SAU board meeting, we will see what that cost is. And it's just something, it's going to stay within that. In my 7 years on the board, it's always been between 15% and 17%. It's always been right around that level, and we'll see that ourselves. But so one of the action items we need to take tonight is to determine who will do the negotiations. I think the easiest suggestion is probably that the chairs just start talking and see if we can get other folks into it. I don't know how you all feel about that. So I certainly might be able to make one on so on for the chair. So that's where we're at, and so
haven't made that goals as planned. Do we know what the contract looks like prior to the meeting?
Absolutely, that's a very good question, and yes, and not only will we look at it for the vote, with what we're hoping for is that the contract will be included in the plan that gets presented to the state Department of Education, so that they can see that everyone is. Yes, the approval process should be very quick because, in essence, very little is changing.
Are you going to have any comparison costs if the choice wasn't made to do that?
We have there in the plan. Yes, there are comparison costs as to what it would have been to do our own SAU and also what the cost would have been to. There was only really one other, no other SAU in the area offered us full services. So that also is difficult. And one was much more expensive.
So Summersworth is very agreeable to that?
Very.
And are they going to present
that's also an excellent question. What the Summersworth Withdrawal Committee has done is essentially say, excellent, we're taking a step back. You'll go forward. Rawlsford will now present their withdrawal plan to the state board. Contract will be included in it. If for some reason it does not get approved by our voters in March, they will reconstitute their withdrawal committee and continue on their withdrawal. So in other words, they're taking a step back, letting this happen, seeing where we go from there. Does that make sense?
As I stated in our report, we covered all the salaries and benefits. We are
are showing a $90,000 savings. However, that does include the apparel that we did not fill at this point. So if we do fill it, that number will go down. It'll still be a savings, but it doesn't include that. We're still waiting for the tuition invoices from March, but I did get the regular education student one today. However, I did not get the special ed one, so until I get that one and we look at it, I'll update you probably next month, I would say. But before then, they will send me the special ed one. It was 149 students on the regular ed. That is lower than we budgeted. I can't remember the exact number.
It looked like students were down.
Yeah. So, but we also did budget a couple of, you know, both students in there as well. So for the next board meeting, I'll do an analysis of, you know, what we budgeted and what we have actual to show you what that savings will be.
Do we have our income or is the tuition not covered?
Do you have our income? Yes, I do. I was waiting for that first bill. I didn't want to encumber what we had budgeted. I want to see what the numbers are going to actually be so we can see the savings. I expect that, you know, like I said, next month. As far as the revenue goes, as I said in my report, the state budget has passed. We did receive, the actual revenue from the state. So in terms of adequacy, Rollinsford is going to get an additional $77,000. However, kindergarten aid, if you remember, that used to be a separate line item. Now they've built it into the adequacy formula. They've gotten rid of kindergarten. That's how originally it was funded, was with Keno money. They've gotten rid of that. So what's going to happen is when the tax rate gets set and they adjust my revenues, kindergarten aid will get zeroed out. So that was $24,200 in the budget. That will get zeroed out. However, adequacy payment is $77,000 more. So you're going to get net.
All right, and if I understand correctly, they haven't fully funded kindergarten, but this year they are fully funded.
Yes, they built it right into the adequacy, yes.
All right, so it's no longer a partial.
It's not, it's going to be the full fund, right.
So at least for this year and next year, that's the fund.
Yeah, and then if you remember correctly, I did also report last month that we are not getting any special education aid because we had no students that qualified. So if you take that $35,000, that's also going to get reduced. So you're looking at a net of about $18,000 between all of those three items. So still an increase, but so that's the revenue piece. I also mentioned in my report, in terms of Medicaid reimbursement, they changed the rules and what we can and who can, you know, sign off on these Medicaid services. So Nancy and I are meeting next week with Multi-State Billing to get some more information. So that'll be one of the things we'll be with them. What we're going to get reimbursed for this year. For Rollinsford, I think we budgeted $10,000. It's not a super amount of money, but still, we want to get some more information.
Are these sort of like normal changes that happen every few years, or normal changes that are
it's something that's been brought up in the past. This year seems to really be the year they really kind of want to go on a little bit more. So, discussion, so I don't think anything's fully finalized yet, but we want to just make sure we're prepared.
And we didn't get as much last year either. We didn't get up to the $10,000 that we had budgeted last year either. So something to look forward, you know, as we create our budget for next year, maybe reducing that line item because we haven't been getting it. So we probably see that as our budget.
And is this one of those things that's sort of a happy misfortune? We're not getting the money, but that needs to be because we don't have students that qualify? Is that, I mean, could we look at it as the good news, bad news thing, or is it all bad news?
I think it's probably a little bit of both.
Yeah.
Okay. Because with the new rules, you may not get even the money that you thought, you know, that we got last year, you may not see that even because of the new rules.
Okay.
But not getting our money last year could be because we didn't have students that qualify, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, it does, but it makes it hard to.
Yeah,
it really does.
Yeah, it really does. And it makes it hard for us to budget because we really don't know what we're doing. So, to me, it's better to budget on the lower end so that way if you get more, that's great. But if you don't get it, then we have to worry.
So I guess the question that comes to mind is, does it appear to be another way that the state needs to put more on the towns than they used to? Or and maybe that's the thing we can't really answer. But one way that the state is not making an obligation to the students.
I think people are getting stricter on the rules of what you can, you know, I think a lot of the department.
about it. It's definitely, there's rules that have been in place and now there's more enforcement around that. So I think it's really more than that, even though everyone, there's been reaction around to say like, well, done it this way for all these years, so why isn't this working? And so I think that's some of the discussion that's happening now, but how can we navigate this? So some districts are looking at significant changes and, in loss of in those funds, and that's concerning, so.
In the bigger cities, the budget of billions of dollars for Medicaid, so they're going to see a significant decrease, whereas, much this much here, but it still is a threat.
And everything that's coming out, like they're just getting a lot of loans together, a lot of, meetings, a lot of different things. So I'm making sure that whatever's coming up for you is next week on a teleconference, so I'm just trying to stay abreast of what direction it's going to go.
Yeah, so it's just sort of all the bringing all up and moving away. Any other questions? Any other questions from the board on the financial?
I just wanted to let the board know that we did put an RFP out for special ed transportation. It's a district-wide contract, so our contract with our own school services is up. It's for both districts, Summersworth and Rollinsworth. Your contract for first student isn't up until next year for regular education. Transportation, Summersworth is up this year, so we had to put out two RFPs, one for Summersworth regular. This one includes Rollinsworth, it's for both districts.
Okay.
So the RFP is out, their bids are due back October 25th. So you're welcome to come that day if you want to see the bids open. If not, I will report out at your November meeting the results so that way you can vote and determine what. And I'll do the same with Summersworth.
And you said they do run on
October 25th at 2 o'clock. So I just wanted you to be aware of that, that's out there, if anybody sees it on the website or,
Is that what they do? Ever able to get a regular transportation?
No, I don't anticipate we're going to get a ton of bids back. So that was my question. And then the timeline is in there, that's the next thing. All I did was mirror what we did last year. Obviously, October 10th was on here, that was tonight, but we decided not to have a budget meeting tonight because it was really too preliminary to have a meeting. So, scratch that one off there. But I just mirrored it against what we did last year. I wasn't sure if anybody had any discussions with the town regarding the deliberative. Last year, we did it on Tuesday night. So I put that same, because the town, I think, asked to be the Saturday.
And that's something,
So this is just a draft, and we don't have to do anything with it tonight, but I did put it in as a Tuesday again. I don't know if the board wanted to continue that. I mean, it was well attended, it wasn't like we didn't have.
That's the deliberative.
That's the deliberative February 4th date.
Yeah.
And it fits.
That's right, that's our decision. In essence, but the town wanted the latest possible Saturday, so that's why,
Yes.
And there's only two Saturdays.
I put the DRA schedule in there as well, so you could see the timelines of when we had to have the meetings. So February 8th is the last time, it was from February 1st to February 8th. So if we had a snow day on the 4th, it puts us on the 8th, which was just the last day you could hold it. But we ran into that last year as well, so.
Right.
I basically mirror the same, just change the dates to this year.
And Emily, I guess on your next meeting with the budget committee, just reviewing to make sure that the school would be presenting to the budget committee on December 12th.
Yeah, I looked it up on the town's website, and that was the meeting that was scheduled. It was already on the website, so I put that in. I just assumed that would be the date. So if it's not, let me know. But I figure we'll next meet and we can finalize this and make sure that he's all
okay. Yeah.
And I assume we'll have a budget meeting ahead of our next meeting.
I'm assuming.
At 5:30.
I'm assuming
it's on here, well. But I assume that's what we'll do. Rich and I have already been working on getting figures together. But for tonight, it was going to be really preliminary.
set up the agenda, I said we normally have, we normally have our first preliminary budget meeting before we vote.
So it says budget committee meeting December 11th, board meeting budget December 12th.
Yeah, that's what I have.
So December 12th we're presenting to?
No, no, I'm sorry.
Okay, it's the 11th.
Okay, that was our meeting, that was my mistake.
I was just making sure that.
And if it works, I mean, I suppose if it works a week later, I don't know when the school. Is that tight? I know that last year we ran into like, it was a little practical, but it's a Christmas, so people are like, it's tight.
Yeah, the 21st.
It's practically like, so I think we want the weekend before, the week before, but Emily, so I mean, if you could get another group, does it make difference? We'll go to the 8th, 12th meeting. And I don't know what you played out on the budget committee. Okay. Do you have a preference?
Holly.
I mean, if anything, I don't know when you're meeting with them, 16th, so you can just let me know.
So the difference to us is that we do not, we will likely then have to have a special meeting. Because it's the day before our school board.
Yeah, right.
When we would have to get for, so we have to go ahead with this one. So that's the time I'm thinking of the school.
See, it's just the code.
Yeah.
So we should go after school.
Well, I think it would be, we wouldn't have to hold like a special meeting just before our meeting on 12th. Just throwing that out as a thought. We all get so busy in our lives. And I don't know.
December 4th is the school for budget.
Is this school, that's what we have on the budget calendar? December 4th, we definitely have school.
Yeah.
That's really old. And again, you can discuss, and if it has to be the 11th, to figure it out, but it has, the town becoming an SB2 would be really good. But for all of us, let's see how Emily's powers of persuasion are.
No, because December 11th is finalized.
Okay, let's see what you can do. Obviously, I'd really end up with the 18th of May.
We'll look at the full schedule and see. Very cooperative last year, so hopefully, this year, celebration, we can work this way.
You know, assuming the budget committee, you know, probably, as I'm assuming that's about the. All right, any other, Doc, helpful as usual, wants to have this company come, so.
Well, it's good to have the DRA one too, so you can see the weeks that you have to hold them, and what's your last possible date, you know, so that we are getting into a time, you know.
Yeah.
Need to pick a date.
Yes. Any other questions, comments, or? All right, new business, so we have first readings of, six policies. All of them are required except the second one, which is recommended, which is the non-discrimination one. So any questions, comments on any of those first six, first reading policies?
Which one is substance now?
It's in here, isn't it?
It's in Miller, so I wasn't sure.
Yeah, so the reason this is here is that we've never had a policy for long-term subs.
Oh.
And, so it became a matter of whatever we pay subs, once someone's here for 8, 9, 10 days for whatever reason, and they become, they're here every day, and they're working on the staff, and they're just here, they're doing their own lesson plans, they're doing everything.
$70 a day.
And this one is going to go, it's going to go up to $100.
$100, or if you are certified in 90.
Why are there enough policies?
Yes, all of the drug, it was like.
They live in different sections of your policy, so on your website, you can see, you know, the G's are staff, J's are students, and so it's the same language, it's just lives in different places, so, you know, if Rich needs to look up something, you know, staff related, you know, we don't want to go and try to figure out where it is, so that's why.
No, I'm just wondering why that.
I know my short term memory is going for that.
I know. I had a little comment on JEC, which starts with page 52, section C, tuition and transportation. It says paid by the summer sort of district.
I guess what's a little curious about the non-discrimination. In that, when it talks about non-discriminating against employees of domestic violence. So is that, that looks like that part was added to this?
Yep, so it's more than
age for that very current.
So we're on the
non-discrimination.
Right, AC. So the question, should we agree with this?
Can you repeat the question?
Sorry. I'm questioning. Well, I'm just, highlighted in yellow about the non-discrimination. We'll not discriminate against any employee who is a victim of domestic violence, harassment, sexual assault, or spousal neglect. I'm just wondering if we need. I guess that the policy doesn't go any further to assist or evaluate the situation. It's really just a policy stating not discriminating.
Right. Victims of that.
Yeah.
So one of the issues, to be honest, with your original policy, and we talked this through, which was the same language in Summersworth, is that I think the idea was to shorten up the language when this was first, this version was put into place a few years ago. But the problem is that if you read through that and if you look at that language, it states, I'm trying to think where it is, so it says you won't discriminate against, you know, national origin, age, sex, sexual orientation, marital status, and it goes on against sexual assault, stalking, you know, and those kinds of things. It's like, well, actually you do, because you don't hire people that have been, you know, convicted of sexual assault. So the language, I think the idea was to shorten it and just, you know, be more concise. However, it doesn't really reflect what your practice is. Because you do discriminate against that, and you have the right to, because you can't, that's usually a crime, you know, when you put a background check. So part of this was to clean that up. And so, but this is the language that's recommended by the School Boards Association. Yeah, it doesn't go into any further detail, just to say you don't discriminate against, you know.
Oh, I see. So, yeah, victim.
Yes, the word victim was missing there, and that's, it's a critical piece. You know, it's distinction before you think through, and you go, oh my. You know, we read that, and we were like, oh, okay, I understand, I think you're thinking, but yeah, the word victim not being in that original policy was concerning. I want to make sure this was.
And also says, and in some of its.
Yes, I apologize for that.
Why? Because, yep, it's possibly the number of things.
Yep, I'll make sure this goes through that again.
Yeah.
I know. We'll get that cleaned up for you.
3 minutes of them. Various tobacco.
conflicts all the time.
The big change there was around adding the e-cigarettes. That was the big change.
I did it, and I read their conflicts, and I didn't see anything. I thought it was interesting that the drug policy makes mention of distributing, and this tobacco one does not. It's just possessing.
Tom, just give us.
I'm assuming that the distinction is that the distribution of drugs, the problem is talking about this and drugs.
Yes.
Cigarettes, that's our. I don't think anybody would ask to distribute cigarettes. But they would be.
Yeah, but this is policy. So we could say that we don't want people.
Distribute.
Student, I'm thinking about students who are selling jewels in school. Because they know.
There should be any on campus. There should be any on.
Right.
Premises.
It says you shouldn't purchase it or attempt to purchase it, but it doesn't say you shouldn't.
Right.
Can we recommend that that be added, that you cannot purchase, sell or purchase? Just if we just add sell before that, each of these policies, we suggest that, but this is probably the language from the school.
It is, but that doesn't mean that you can't have.
I think that's a reasonable thing to add, right? That how people feel about it.
It's important to add it.
You don't think we need it, Tom?
How would you ever, this is like, you're gonna have people that are bringing this in. Let's face it, you're gonna have kids that are gonna have this. If you're talking about just being, I don't think, you're either gonna have a rule that if you're caught with anything, even on your personal belongings, which I don't know how that works. If they're able to say, you have one of those jewel things, you know, deep in the confines of your backpack, you're not showing it to anybody, you're not giving it to anybody, who cares? Are you saying it's a rule that they're not allowed to have any of those things on premises? Is that the rule?
I think that's it.
So you're talking K through 6 on this one?
We're not actually.
Okay.
We're talking, these are for the Walter School District, which does include, even though the Logan School where plays and follow the policies of that. But they would, yeah, but we would be applying to K through 6.
It's
K through 12, but our 7 through 12 follow Marshall's policies.
So I, if someone in K through 6 had this in their backpack, I would think that would be possible.
Well, my understanding of the school policies are that they're not new. On the person, they can be suspended from school. That's not what Marshall.
So.
Yeah, at Marshall.
So. It says distributing or.
It doesn't say distributing or something.
I don't know. I think that.
So I guess, does that cover it? Does that cover it then? I mean, if they have it on the person, whether they're using it or selling it or.
I think we need this.
Well, I'm not sure we have that. It simply says that they can't use it on school property. It doesn't say they can't have it.
You can't possess it.
If you can't possess it on school property, let's say everything else.
Possess, you're right. Possess where you do it. So I think, so it looks
Central Public.
This, right?
Okay.
So we don't need to do anything without adding, because I mean, I see what you're saying.
That's our first.
Right, you know, I mean, I.
I mean, clearly you're not allowed to have illicit drugs on the school, but they also put that.
Yes, exactly.
So consistency.
Other things for discussion, we will vote, be voting on those at our next meeting.
I think the one, the other one that I have is on.
Any other on the first meetings? All right, so we'll move on to the second meetings. We discussed them the last time, and we did have a discussion with Bob about the recommended retention. And his thought was, and I agree with him, but he wanted to know about security sort of and stuff, and he felt that this is student data recommended retention, and that the security stuff should be a separate policy.
Definitely review that.
Student record, okay, well then I think that's something that perhaps we should pull down.
A policy on video and audio surveillance on school property. It's policy EAA. Bob mentioned that we had this conversation last time, so I was curious what you already had, because I think the intent of EHB, because it also goes into specialized records, it's not just student records, it's financial records. I mean, there's a lot, of state's world, you know, is also kind of overseen as far as how long we have to keep different records.
Even with the SAP with all the boxes upstairs, things like that.
All the compliance stuff we have to do, that's crazy. But a lot of this is, you know, legal documents that we have to, documents we have to legally keep. Whereas video is, it's not, but it can be a part of a student record. Nancy thinks maybe the special ed piece of that. But what your policy says, there is a statement, you know, in the third paragraph that says the district will retain copies of video recordings until they are erased. Which may be accomplished by either deletion or by copying of the new record. The superintendent will consult with the necessary personnel to determine how and when such recording should be deleted. So it doesn't give you like a time frame. It doesn't, you may want to, you know, have some consideration about, you know, is it after a year's time? You know, if you have surveillance cameras around the building, after the school year's done,
or is it once a week, or is it whatever?
Right.
No, it's a lot of data, so sometimes you have to do it wrong.
And my concern is I don't want us to necessarily state in a public session how long we keep security tips. But one of the things that I know Rich will be prepared to tell us something in the future, it's not prepared to tell, but he'll be prepared to something in the future, and we'll find out what the time frame is that we're there.
Yeah.
We don't know that. Actually, we don't know that a lot of the security teams. So that will.
Right, I was thinking we didn't have further discussion about that. But so you do have policy about it. It just doesn't maybe define it more clearly or in some financial
way. It's an interesting point because those cameras, the cameras that we're talking about are security cameras. They're not taping a student in a lesson. And I understand the concerns. I completely, but they can be used. But if there's a disciplinary reason, then it would have to have been saved somehow. Yes. Well, we don't know. Well, we can save it for a certain amount of time. It's probably not saved forever. I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
It just says that it would be, you know, it talks a little bit about, you know, if there's a disciplinary matter. And again, it's very broad. It just says, you know, it will be saved in accordance with the law, you know, whatever that applicable law could be, depending on probably the circumstances.
But unless it's, if it's not saved, it's not available.
But I think it's different from student records. I mean, I'm thinking it's different from student records, but I'm not being very good at articulating the difference at the moment.
I wonder what other schools do.
No, I think I think I understand what you're saying, like, but I also think that, first of all, today, it's not a case, you know, it's not considered a student record, but who knows what the future use is of that. And also, I think that if it's something, you know, if we are saying that there's an obligation on the playground, and a child disappears because of that, that becomes, right, that video becomes part of their disciplinary record or potentially.
I think that's the question. So I'm still thinking it's a separate policy. But I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
But
I mean, generally a record detention schedule just covers all records. So that's why.
So my thought is, if something were used in a disciplinary action, it would be pulled out, that video piece would be pulled out and put in the records. Maybe, particularly if it becomes illegal outside of a school district, or anything that might have to go to court or something would be pulled out. But that's my thing. And then therefore it does become part of perhaps that student's record. But not just general security tapes. I don't know.
No, yeah, I guess. I don't necessarily think, I don't necessarily know whether it's a student record or a student record in a records retention schedule. Like, I don't see, we have accounts receivable stuff in here, we have budget worksheets, we have construction contracts. You know, this is not specific to student records. This is a records retention schedule, period, very broad.
Although we do have a separate security security record policy.
This is a record detection schedule, which is a legal document that says after this is being a policy in
place. So maybe it goes on the detention test.
Yeah.
I see what you're saying. Well, I think this would require more thought and more discussion.
I think that we should have something that says that we're collecting all this information. We need something to say that how long we're supposed to be here.
So what is the best way to go to sort of do that to reach? Just leave this sort of open for more discussion?
Yes.
Find out what other schools do. I didn't pull up the school association guidance on this one, so I can certainly look at that. This was you approved this policy in 2016. A lot, that doesn't sound like it was that long ago. A lot has changed in the world of technology, videos, and surveillance. You know, so there may be some thought around, you know, more defined process-wise, because it's just the language I was reading to you, okay, pretty broad. And you want that to some extent in the policy, so you can take it and hone it down from there. But yeah, so I can have a conversation with Bob about having
be a legal requirement.
I think you've got it also in the transportation policy, you know, videotaping on our buses as well. And I think it's in there about keeping the video for so long. It's also in that policy.
Yeah, I was thinking that too, like the video.
I think it's in that policy.
It's
in transportation as well. And I think the more information for the conference of the school board association talked about
videotaping. Right. So
okay.
Trying to get, you know, a lot of things are happening so quickly. School Boards Association a little behind, you know, and trying
but
to
it's,
get
but
some
you,
things. It's a good discussion.
But all the videotaping is true, whether the security cameras are all over the videotaping, it is a huge concern, obviously, in society now. And I think we just get used to being videotaped. Maybe not even, don't even realize that we're
types of videotaping that's happening.
Yeah.
You know, it's in that one, it's the bus one, it might be another one, it might be another one.
And that just becomes a...
Right, trying to create a consistent practice across the board, because you have different policies and different, you know, pieces and different policies, so...
Okay, so we're sort of...
So we'll gather some information, further information for you on this, and it sounds like Nancy may have gotten some pieces as well, so we can look at that.
And do you have something else on there, or is that from you?
That was it.
Anyone else on others there? I did notice on the local record retention schedule, I know it's an R, but I guess because it's attached to PHP, that it's also required, it didn't have a required or requested, but it just has it as the schedule.
A lot of times the Rs don't have, you just don't put that in there, but it's the Rs don't often have that other qualifier. Tried to, they're both, you saw that in the financial policies, a lot of those didn't have that piece in there, and so we had to go through that for the auditors, and it's like, well, let's add this in there, just so it just adds that level of detail for you, so, because there are some that are definitely required, gotta have, and that's the way it needs to be, and a lot of reference. And then there was some optional ones as well, so...
Okay, well, all right. I'm just gonna bring this up, because it seems like the right place to do it, on the student wellness policy, which is, it looks like it's new, I guess. And a lot of work was done on it, and once we pass it, there's gonna be work to be done, setting up committees and doing all these things. But one of the things that I thought about as I was reading through it, particularly as I got to the end of it, as it talks about physical activity, wellness, health, we currently have a physical education teacher, a physical education health, two days a week. And I think as a board, as we start talking about budgets, so this is the important thing about budgeting, but we should start talking about and asking our administrators and people to look at, do we have the right level of physical education, health, wellness, so I have in school, which is something we need to be talking about. About the week or whatever, and maybe, because now's the time to start looking at it, because we do need to put a budget to add a day or whatever. So I just wanted to bring that up to everybody. It's brought up a nice thing, the policy, how important things are. So let's just keep that in mind as we start looking at what sort of direct bond and start looking at what that might take. And if they feel it's warranted as well. All right, so do we want to remove the record retention and vote on the others?
On the change of school or assignment, that's of interest. You know, I reading it.
We're back to the first reading.
My bad.
No, that's good. That's fine. We're backing up. I just want to let them know that.
Okay, I wasn't to that detail. Is it okay if I speak back?
Yes, of course you
may. All right. I mean, it's pretty clear that, parent or guardian, child that is served or has a hardship, or they have some circumstance to go to another. I just was reading, it doesn't really talk about, I know it's the superintendent kind of looks at that and then would come to the board, but I was curious, it doesn't really get into costs, the town then, I guess the board would have to vote on it and approve it. Would it go to the town, or would it just be something that we, because this is not necessarily special education.
No, it's
right.
It's not, because it could be a number of circumstances. This is for some reason that there's been, that family is coming forward to you to say, my child would be better served in another school. And so then the board, through the superintendent, has to make the decision about
on this is that I think up until last year or the year before, superintendents did this on their own. Boards did not have to be involved.
Yes.
I think that's true. And so the big change was that it became the board policy and boards have to be involved now. Superintendents can no longer just do it on their own. It used to be, you know, they'd call up and say, you know, I've got a kid here who's not doing great, and there's a chip on the door. Usually there was not a cost involved, so the superintendents just wouldn't be able to do it. That's my understanding. I don't know if there was a cost amount, but so it's relatively new that boards have to now approve of these things. I don't know if that helps, but it's
right. They wanted to shore up the process, I think, and so that there's deterrence, because a lot of times you are paying a tuition bill to someone else, and I think that, you know, if you're looking at how you're spending funds, then, you know, that should be something that is ready to go.
Does that answer, probably doesn't answer your question exactly.
It doesn't. I guess they're presenting the school, or we wouldn't necessarily come with other options for the school. Sounds like it's all done.
It's kind of done, right, through the process, and then it's presented to you. This is what, you know, usually I think the superintendent recommend. You know, this is what, as we've gone through this vetting process, you know, the evidence, the reasoning, all of those kinds of things. Superintendent will often make calls or, you know, have conversations with various people at the current school, and we, you know, post school, you know, and then be able to come back to you and say to you, this is my recommendation, you know, to offer this.
Any other questions? What we will do then for the second readings is take a motion to accept all except EHB and EHBR. Right? At the moment?
Yes. To accept all policies as written that are on the second reading, except for the verbal interpretations.
And some of them are changed.
Yes, as clarified, let's get to that.
So that's AC-R, BCA, GBEA, and JLCF. To be accepted, is there a second? Any further discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye. And Erin reminded me earlier today that RTS handbook, but it wasn't here in time for us to review, so we didn't understand it all, but it'll be in the end of the year next, or next, and we had to do the authorized communication devices. Authorized communication devices. So what you're proposing for the we have our old business. So the Marshwood tuition agreement, as we reviewed it last time, it was noted that one of the things that we continually discussed and wanted in there was that was indeed added. Some of the other stuff that I had hoped to be there, legally we couldn't do, because we do have to go in front of the public again to extend it. So there was a lot of that. So have people had a chance to review that and look at it? And are you ready to vote on it this evening?
Contracts, and I don't
even if we want to extend it. So if we just extended, and we still had we still have four years to go. Anyways, we still have quite a ways to go. So we still have quite a ways to go. There was, I don't believe in the original contract, there was a way for them to offer their definition.
Yeah, so, but they... My notification of our...
Is that true?
Terminating. Is this, yes, it is. It's on page 19. So... So if we choose to not renew, right, then we need to give them 2 years notice.
Correct.
Or they charge us a 2 year to a contract. But if they choose not to renew,
I see what you're saying. That they really should give us the same notice if they're going to choose not to renew. It was sort of a suit, yeah.
Right. Withdrawal, expiration, conclusion, or termination of this agreement, Marco agrees to allow the continued through graduation. At Marco's request and authorization.
Yes.
Definitely, so all your friends, Facebook, any fans.
One year, look, people Facebook, on the town blog. Town blog. Pushes things out. I don't know the timing or which sends out. Send something out to parents every month.
Yeah, the last each month.
Should we go to the
Just send more.
Local.
So let's go.
It's early, well, it's kind of early in the month, but it's good to get the story.
Yeah. I mean, you can get it posted. Maybe it's like a bigger. Maybe we can have six parents make posters.
Put them around town. Does the town still send out that email?
Yes, yeah, that's, but I think that's what comes up with the idea. So she might work, and she might work out to these pictures. Hopefully, that's what's along.
Yep. And maybe draft some text and something around.
That sounds good. I agree, just in terms of, I want to double check.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I want to double check.
That's it. I don't know how many of the alert now calls which done, but I need more, and so I'm going to say more, because when you said, something, you sound like a call, like a couple of weeks ahead of time, and then you do the text message to folks, and that's another option.
You might get more parents.
If you want to draft some language, you can certainly do that for this.
Try to cover all the bases, that's right. Excellent. And the rest are our regular school board, school board, and we do an SAU meeting on November 18th. And we will have a first one of the SAU budget at that time.
Don't forget your November 14th, planning on 5:30 budget workshop prior to that.
Right. That will be, no, but we will be starting early on November 14th.
5:30.
So just very quickly looking at our goals for this year, I mean, the first one we have was the school board will support the SAU 56 withdrawal committee and complete the process. So we are taking the, one of the final steps in the process, which is helping to get the plan completed by opening negotiations and the summer's work that will happen. And our second one was for the school board to continue discussions on the appropriateness of sending loans for grade 6 students partially, and that's in the works. We have a meeting scheduled to do that, so good work. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the entire withdrawal committee. Now, they're not here tonight, but they've worked really hard. They put in a lot of time, a lot of thought. They were very thoughtful. Every single member was incredibly thoughtful. Their comments were, just, I thought, and the research they did was really, really good. And they wanted to do what was best for the school district, but also for the town. Yeah, excellent. I'm hoping they'll stay involved in school district stuff. All right, we do have a non-meeting to go into after this, but we'll take, are there closing comments by visitors? Nancy?
The only thing I have is, can that fan be shut off during your meeting? Because I can't hear you guys talking.
So I told them that I couldn't shut it off because my facilities guy is not here tomorrow morning, and it's our meeting. I can't come
then to maybe we should hold the meeting down here.
Already way ahead of you. Normally it's not an issue because if we have school the next morning, he's here before us and can turn it on, but he's not here tomorrow.
Okay.
I'm
curious.
I'm
sorry, could you state your name, please?
Erica Gagnon. I was curious if it might be beneficial to have a few of the students that have transitioned to Marshall, if you're not near me.
Barely.
I was wondering if it might be helpful to have some of the students that have transitioned to Marshwood talk about their experiences, and if they thought it might have been beneficial to transition in the sixth grade versus the seventh grade when everyone else transitioned. If there'd be any kids that'd be willing to answer questions from big adults, but I don't know if that would.
It's an excellent, I think it's an excellent suggestion. We have talked about that.
She's got some thoughts.
She has some thoughts. Well, I think that was part of it. So it's
yeah, she's an eighth grader. Yeah, I can try to see if my son would be willing to speak up. He's a seventh grader, but I don't know. We'll see.
Well, I think it's probably worth also checking in with the three, middle school student reps to see if they wanted to comment, and if Nick wanted to comment as student reps. And I think, you know, if they are student reps, and let's see if they would want to comment.
Could also something be written down by some kids, maybe read by somebody else? Because sometimes it's very intimidating for a child to get up in front of a group. Like, say your son has something to say, maybe you could read it for him, just as a thought. Because I know how I feel getting up in front of a group, and I'm an adult. So that's a thought maybe too, whether or not that would be doable, valid.
Non-meeting
All right. Motion carries. Thank you all very much.